Hello, I'm Tekla Kluttik and I'm working as an archivist at the State Archives in Leipzig. And first of all, I want to apologize for my German accent. I like to present you copybooks, directories of plate numbers, production records, in short, archival records of music publishers in the Sächsisches Staatsarchiv, Staatsarchiv Leipzig. Leipzig once was the center for German music publishing, and numerous publishers and printers were based here. This elevated position was brought to an abrupt end when the graphic quarter of Leipzig was bombed in December 1943, and then in the years following 1945, many prominent publishers left for the western occupied zones. The war caused irretrievable losses to company records too. Those records that survived the war and had not been removed remained for the main part in situ. In 1955, the State Archive Leipzig was founded. Due to the nationalization of a number of commercial enterprises and the newly implemented archive laws in the German Democratic Republic, it became the body responsible for the collections of nationalized and expropriated publishers in Leipzig. From the 1960s on, more and more records found their way into the state archives. From the 1970s, more finding aids were available for the collections, beginning with card catalogues, later typewritten inventories, Findbücher. On the basis of these, the collections were in principle available to scholars. But the obstacles facing researchers from outside the GDR were high and little was known of the archive's contents. Following the peaceful revolution of 1989, it became possible for previous owners to apply for the restitution of their expropriated property. The former owners of the music publishing companies Anton J. Benjamin, Breitkopf & Hertel, Friedrich Hofmeister, C.F. Peters, Edition Peters, and Wilhelm Zimmermann made use of this option. In 1992 and 1993, these publishers had their records retransferred to them, but with the exception of the archival holdings of the music publisher Wilhelm Zimmermann, the records remained at the State Archives in Leipzig. What is meant by archival holdings of a music publisher? Correspondence with business partners, composers, musicians and musicologists, conservatories and music theaters both at home and abroad, internal records, publishing contracts, business documents concerning production and sales, sheet music in every stage of production, from autographs to engravers' copies and proofs. All of these were accrued by music publishing houses in the course of their business. So I'm not talking about the so-called Publikationsarchive, the collections of printed notes in the sense of deposit copies. In our holdings, there are printed notes too, but only as an exception, not as a rule. The most significant collection, both in quantity and quality, of these kinds of records from the 19th and 20th century in the German-speaking world can be found in the Sächsisches Staatsarchiv, Staatsarchiv Leipzig, the State Archives of Saxony in Leipzig. You get an impression by the list above. 19 of our more than 2,000 collections contain records from 21 music publishers. These archival holdings range from fragmentary material of only 50 centimeters up to the largest collection, Breitkopf & Hertel, Leipzig, which encompasses approximately 300 running meters. The collections are built according to the principle of provenance or respect de fond, so the records of the same provenance are generally left in the original order in which they were created and kept. The most significant collections for the golden period of music publishing in Leipzig up until 1943 are the records of the publishers Breitkopf & Hertel and C.F. Peters, Edition Peters. Together, these comprise around 420 running meters of documents. Here is just a view in one of our storage rooms. Here you see one-third of the collection of C.F. Peters. At this point, I expect a basic knowledge of the history and significance of Breitkopf & Hertel and C.F. Peters and focus on three kinds of their archival records. When it comes to Breitkopf & Hertel, The first publishing records in the strict sense of the term date back to 1818. An almost complete series of approximately 560 books of copied letters has survived, spanning the period from 1818 until 1910, when a different record system was introduced. The copybooks contain handwritten or carbon copies of outgoing correspondence in chronological order. Here you see three books made for carbon copies on transparent paper. In German, the technique is called Abklatsch. An additional series of letter copybooks, the Kopierbücher Expedition, dating from 1890 to 1910 and consisting of 115 books of carbon copies of outgoing letters, document the worldwide sales of sheet music. Further letter copybooks include outgoing letters to the branches in Brussels and London, providing a detailed insight into the development of European markets. Here you see a double page from an older copybook with handwritten copies of outgoing correspondence in chronological order, dating from October 1850. On the right side, you see, for example, the copy of a letter written to Marot in Paris, on page 379. If you want to find a certain letter, you first have to search the alphabetical registries for the names. In this example, you see the sheet concerning the letter M. In the detail, you see the list of the pages of letters to Marot in Paris. We just saw the one on page 379. There are a lot of more in this copybook. Now you know about the copybooks of Breitkopf and Hertel. Let's have a look on Sieff Peters' Bureau de Musique. Letter copybooks with handwritten and, after 1904, carbon copies of the company's outgoing correspondence start in 1881. Surprisingly, the publishing house continued to utilize this technique until 1940. It is noticeable that during the 19th century, the bookkeeping was less precise than at Breitkopf and Hertel. There are several large gaps between the entries. We can assume that many times a letter was sent off without being registered in a copybook. Just to show you the amount of outgoing letters, these are numbers concerning the letters in the Breitkopf and Hertel copybooks from the years 1840 and 1850, in total and with regard to certain countries. They clearly show the wide geographic range of activities. Unfortunately, almost no corresponding letters sent to Breitkopf and Hertel spanning the entire 19th century have survived the Second World War. The situation concerning the documentation of the publishing company Bureau de Musique, taken over in 1814 by Carl Friedrich Peters, is quite different. As a company building on Thalstraße was not destroyed during the Second World War, the papers stored there survived. Following an initiative started by Hans Martin Pleske, a staff member at the Deutsche Bücherei, most of the current collection was transferred to the State Archives in Leipzig in 1966. There it was processed by Pleske and his wife in the following years. Pleske's work is doubtlessly to be held in high esteem. However, from an archivist's perspective, it must be said that his main focus was on autographic tidbits. For instance, his superficial descriptions of what, from a present-day perspective, constitute a central part of the collection, the plate and publishing directories, hardly do justice to their significance. The Druckbuch Literar A, gehalten von Karl Gotthelf Sigmund Böhme unter der Firma C.F. Peters in Leipzig, for example, contains information on the size of a print or reprint run and when the plates were melted down, all arranged alphabetically under the composer's name, from 1831 to 1867. Here are the numbers to some works of Louis Spohr. The Druckbuch printing book was digitized, and you can find the scans in our online information system. As another example, a detail to Beethoven's Adelaide. You can see how often it was printed from 1832 up to 1864. It's like publishing on demand. Here you can see the description of this archival object, the druck book in our online information system. The collection of C.F. Peters also contains documents originating with and pertaining to the publishing house Rita Bietermann, which was bought by C.F. Peters in 1917. With regard to Rita Bietermann, the three calculation books are especially significant. They cover the period 1856 up to 1919, and the publication numbers 1 to 2956, and contain an overview of printing costs and dates, including reprints. In this example, you see the details to Johannes Brahms, Deutsches Requiem, the first print, second print, third print, etc. These calculation books are digitized and can be found online too. The directories of the different music publishers stored at the State Archives Leipzig present an important source for publishing catalogs and sales. They show when which works were first printed, when reprints were issued and how many, as well as the payment of composers. They provide a wealth of interesting information that goes beyond the publishing history of individual composers. They encompass entire publishing catalogs, well-known as well as now unknown authors, sales hits, as well as important works that were less in demand. The last important group of primary sources I like to mention are the scores and sheet music that form part of the music publisher's archival holdings. The collection of Breitkopf & Härtel in the State Archives Leipzig contains considerable quantities of sheet music in various stages of production, manuscripts, engravers' copies, proofs, and prints. These were created as part of the production process, which they document in various ways. This applies to the approximately 700 extant individual works, as well as to an even larger number of scores, which were used as working material in preparing complete editions. We keep especially engravers' copies and proofs relating to the following complete editions beginning in the midst of the 19th century: Johann Sebastian Bach, Ludwig van Beethoven, Hector Berlioz, and so on. You can see it on the sheet. I will get later to the edition from Franz Liszt. This material frequently consists of printed music, which was used by the publishers to produce new print masters, but also of comments, revision reports, and manuscripts for introductions. So, on the left side, there is a detail from a proof of Robert Schumann's Blumenstück, with hints to the music engraver from Clara Schumann, from 1818. You see her signature below. On the right side, there is a cover page of a work by Bach, in a revision of Ferruccio Busoni from 1897. We processed these materials just a few years ago, after signing a new contract about the deposit with the owner of the material. What was former one package is, for now, for example, now arranged in 9 logical units which can be described in a useful way. Since then, we improved the descriptions of the material step by step. Here you see the online description of one of the 9 folders I just mentioned. But what about access? All collections of music publishers in the State Archives have been made accessible as sources for academic and private research. You can inform yourself in our online information system through the metadata to the form and the descriptions of the archival objects. Actually, archival inventories of 11 forms by music publishers are accessible online. About 600 handwritten works from the 19th century and the publishers Breitkopf & Härtel, C.F. Peters and C.F. Kahnt are described in the RISM OPAC, thanks to the RISM Arbeitsstelle Dresden. You can use a simple search box, or you can do a systematic research using the Beständeübersicht. The collections of music publishers belong to the business records, so you find them under Wirtschaft. And due to their immense scale, we use classifications to improve the orientation for researchers. You can have a look at the research possibilities on our website. In the end, what's the use of it all? We want the collections to be used. We offer convenient research possibilities in our reading rooms, including personal consultation if wanted. We get a lot of inquiries, usually via email, and answer at a good pace, usually within 1 or 2 days. The researchers can make reproductions themselves, or we make them on demand. However, researching primary sources in archives, like the records of a publishing house from the 19th century, requires special skills. In the archival discussion in North America, they are described as archival literacy competencies, but that's another story. Many thanks for your attention. I hope you enjoyed my presentation about archival records of music publishers in the State Archives in Leipzig. Have a good day.